So, as I have mentioned, okay, each neuron, okay, is dealing with a two-dimensional receptor field, right? So, okay, so you can formulate so such that a neuron located in row I, column J of a layer is connected to the output of the previous layer of the neurons in the previous located in rows I to I plus FH minus 1. Sorry, rows I to I plus FH minus 1. And the columns from J to J plus FW minus 1. This FH and FW are the heights and the width of the receptor field. Okay? So it's like this. Okay? It's like this. Okay? So that, okay, the next neuron, for example, if it is moving to the next row, okay, you can see the corresponding receptive field is also moving along that row for one position. Okay, for one position. Okay, and so on. Okay. And one thing that you may wonder, this is the case for where the height and the width for this perceptive field are the same. Okay, FH and FW are both three. Okay, and in order for a layer to have the same height and width as the previous layer, it is common to add zeros around the input. Okay, this is called zero padding. Okay, for example, okay, we start from here. Okay, so we actually, in order for each node, each neuron here to map to this corresponding field. Okay, and to make sure the size of this layer is the same as the size of the next one. Okay, apparently you need to kind of enlarge this layer a little bit, so that when you go to the boundary, okay, when you go to the boundary, okay, you can still have the same size of the receptive field, right? So this is done by putting zeros, okay, for this out of bound area. Okay, originally each of these will be the output of the neuron in this layer. Okay, but this part of this gray area will always output or remains to be zero. That's the basic idea. Okay, so this is what we call zero pattern. This is normally how we use. Okay. And also, okay, it is possible to connect a large input layer to a smaller layer by spacing out the receptor field. Okay, what do I mean? Okay, as shown next slide, okay? So, if this one is mapped to this area, then, okay, we can move, okay, along this dimension, okay, we can move two units along this dimension, and then the next neuron is connected to this one, instead of moving this dimension for only one unit, we move on this dimension for two units, okay, so the length of this movement, the length of this movement, okay, for each dimension is called stride. Stride, okay. So for the stride, okay, so this example, okay, this example, each neuron has like a prosthetic field, prosthetic field of 3x4. 3x3 prosthetic field, okay, with a stride of 2. Okay, so in this example, okay, we are using the stride of 2 for both width and height, okay. But keep in mind, the stride, okay, for width can be different from the stride from width, from height, Okay, the width and the height, or the width and the height, the stride could be different. So that's the first thing, okay. The second thing is that, okay, also, in this example, you can treat this example, the basic one, as like a, well, the stride of length one, on both directions, okay. And for example, if you use a stride of 2, okay, then roughly, okay, on average, this two-dimensional area will be shrinked by half, okay. For both width and height, for both width and height, roughly speaking, okay. Of course, this is the case when the stride is 2. If the stride is 3, then the next layer will shrink, okay, by a factor of 3. Okay, so on. So you get an idea, okay. So after incorporating the stride, the concept of the stride, okay, then we can say that a neuron, okay, located in row I, column J, okay, is connected to the output of the neuron in the previous layer located in row I times SH to I times SH plus FH minus 1. Okay, FH is the same, okay, it's the height of your prosthetic field, okay, and the SH is your stride length for the height, okay. As for the row, for the column, it's from column J to the column J plus times SW to J times SW plus FW minus 1. Again, SW represents the stride used for the width. Okay, the FW is the width of the your prosthetic field. Okay. So by doing so, we sort of implementing the concept of like a biological neural network, okay, for the prosthetic field, okay, and also it's not fully connected, right? But how about each neuron will be focusing on a special feature, okay, more for example like a special orientation of line segment, okay. So that is done by what we call convolution kernels, okay? Sometimes we also call that as filters, okay? So they basically mean the same thing, okay? The neuron's weight, okay, can be represented as a small image, the size of the receptive field, okay? So for example, the figure next slide, okay, show two possible sets of weight. They call filters, okay. or convolution kernel. Okay. So the first one is represented as a black square with a vertical white line in the middle. Okay. So it's like a 7x7 matrix full of zero. Okay. Zero means it's a black. Okay. Because everything multiplied by zero becomes zero. Right. Okay. So it's you can consider that as a dark. Okay. Black. Okay. And the white just means that, everything multiplied by one relents to be itself, right? So we keep that, or we keep the original value, okay? So it's like, this one. This is a 7x7 size. Matrix, okay, and you can see the vertical line. There's a white line, vertical line. Okay, that white vertical line basically represents like the because it's a 7x7 matrix, so it's like the middle column contains like all whites, okay, and all the other elements are zero. Okay, so this is one filter. Okay, we call it vertical filter. The other one is horizontal. Okay, in which like all the elements are zero except the middle row. Okay, which contains ones. Okay. So in other words, like filters, okay, remember this filter is of size, has the same size as the receptive here, okay, So when you are getting the input from the receptive here, okay, when you are getting value from each of these receptive here, you actually will apply this filter along this instruction, along the instruction. Okay? So, you can see that, okay? Say, if we have this input image, okay, then if you use in the next level, okay, say you get this one as an input, okay, in the convolution layer, okay, you use the 7x7 receptive here, okay, and use stride one. Use stride one on both direction, okay, and also during this process, you apply the vertical field like this, okay. The resulting figure will look like this, okay. This is the situation. The other situation is that you are doing similar thing, but this time you are applying the horizontal filter, okay, on each computation of receptive here. So this is the result of the computation. So you can see that, okay, the vertical filter actually will strengthen, it's going to strengthen the feature, the vertical feature, okay, and the horizontal filter, okay, if you use that, it is going to strengthen the horizontal feature, okay. So that is, the idea that we are trying to create the neural which is specialized for specific feature, okay, for specific line segment, something like that, okay, so special orientation line segment, okay. So the output, okay, each of these output, okay, will be what we call feature map. Feature map. So this one is a feature map. This one is also a feature map. Basically, in a convolutional layer, after applying a filter, what you are getting, okay, is a feature map, basically. Okay, so this feature map will highlight the area in the image that are most similar to the filter. It's going to strengthen that, actually. So during training, a CM finds the most useful filters for its task, and it learns to combine them into more complex patterns. Just for example, the example I just mentioned, a close is an area in an image where both vertical filter and horizontal filter are active. Okay. And you can stack up the feature maps together, okay? So for simplicity, okay, we have represented each convolution layer as a thin 2D layer, but in reality, it is composed of several feature maps of equal size. Okay, so it's more accurately represented in 3D, okay? In 3D, because like another dimension represents like you are applying that two-dimensional figure through several filters. Okay, so each filter will give you a different feature map. So you are end up having many, many feature maps. Okay, so it's like this. So you are going to have many, many feature maps. Okay, so you can see that it's actually three dimensional. Instead of two dimensional, it's three dimensional. So within one feature map, all neurons share the same parameters, okay, with a biased term. But different feature maps may have different parameters, okay? So this is like doing this allows us to simplify the convolutional layer significantly. Okay, so neurons receptive here is the same as described earlier, but it extends across all previous layers, feature maps. Okay, so the conclusion is a convolutional layer simultaneously applies multiple filters to its input, making it capable of detecting multiple features anywhere in its input. So this is an important concept. Okay, so you may wonder, like, how about like if we have like a three-dimensional data, such as like image obtained from like a telescope, like for outer space. Okay, the example I just told you. Then, okay, still you are going to have different feature maps. So the result is going to be four-dimensional. Okay. Well, although we cannot draw the four-dimensional object, but at least like, well, conceptually you can imagine that. Okay. So the fact that all neurons in a feature map share the same parameter dramatically reduce the number of parameters in the model. So as I said, this allows us to simplify the C convolutional layer a lot. Okay. But most importantly, it means that once the CN has learned to recognize a pattern in one location, it can recognize the same pattern in any other location. So this is also very important. Okay, for example, if it is able to recognize crows, then for the crows happen at any location in the photo, it is able to recognize that. So in contrast, once a regular steer has learned to recognize a pattern in one location, it can recognize it only in that particular location. It may not be able to generalize. Okay, to generalize that to different location, okay, take extra effort in the DNN. But for the CNN, because we share the same parameter, so generalizing like a recognized pattern from one location to another is nothing. It's basically just like, it's a, you know, if you can recognize a pattern, well, you can recognize that pattern anywhere in the program. Okay, so that's a good, another good thing. Okay. So in this figure, not only you can see that different feature, different filters, okay, create like a third dimension, okay, now like a lot of feature maps. You also see here, okay, very important, okay, in, even in a photo, okay, because most of the time we are dealing with like a colored photo, okay, colored photo. So, image also are composed of multiple sublayers. So one per color channel. Okay. So if you are dealing with a colored photo, okay, normally we will have like a red, green, and a blue channels. Okay. Something like this. So the photo is actually you can separate like a different channel, okay, like a kind of like a sort of like a break one photo into three input layers, three input layers. Okay. Of course, like if the photo is black and white, or another way to call it is a grayscale, right? If it's grayscale, then we will have just one channel, okay? But as I said, some images may have much more, okay? Satellite images that capture actual light frequency, okay? Or what we call spectrums, okay? Such as infrared, okay? In that case, the photo, okay? Then we need to consider this, we have like, you know, many sublayers. Okay. Okay. So now we can say that okay. After going through all these concepts, okay, including the width and the height of a stepped field, including the stride length for the vertical stride and the horizontal stride, including the feature maps, okay, a lot of feature maps, and including like a color channels, okay. Then okay, you can say neuron locating rho I color j all. The feature map K, okay, now we have the feature map K here, okay. In a given convolutional layer L, okay, so this is like we now also specify this is for a particular layer of convolution layer, okay. This is convolutional layer L. It's connected to the output of the neurons in the previous layer, L minus 1, okay, located in rho I times SW to I times SW plus FW minus 1. This part is really the same, okay? And the column from J times H to J times H SH plus FH minus 1. So this part, again, remains the same. Across all feature maps. Okay? Across all feature maps. Okay, so this is the same thing. Originally, we just for that previous layer, you know, nice one, just one layer. Now we are across all the feature maps of that previous layer. Okay? So know that all neurons located in the same row I and the column J but with different feature maps are connected to the output of the exact same neuron in the previous layer. Okay? So if it's like Rho I current J, it is connected to the same neuron, okay? Because the I is like stays there, and I stay there, J is there, and J stays there. Okay, so now, okay, if you want to really like write it in a more formal way, so this is an equation that summarizes like all the information we have in the previous slides. Okay, we put it in a big mathematical like form. Okay, so Z I J K. So Z I J K is the output of the neural motility. Rho I current J official map K of the convolutional layer L. Okay, we didn't specify L here, but it's implicitly assumed it's layer. It's on a layer L. Okay, and the other part, I think, the other part is similar to what we already talked about here. So I think I will skip this. You guys can have a look. Okay. Just to validate if this is the same as the previous one. Okay. And how do we implement the convolutional layer in TensorFlow? Okay. So. Each input image is typically represented as a 3D tensor of shape, height, width, and channel. Okay, because now we also need to incorporate the concept channel. Okay, so mini batch is represented as a 4D tensor of shape, mini batch size, height, width, channels. And this mini batch size, we normally do not know that. Until the runtime, right? So we execute that. Okay. We normally keep it blank. Okay. Normally keep it blank. So width of a convolutional layer are represented as 4D tensor shape. FH, FW, FN, and FN prime. Okay. That's the width of a convolutional layer. Okay. So bias terms of a convolutional layer are simply represented as 1D tensor of shape. Okay? So the example is shown in the next slide. Okay, this example actually is used to generate this. Okay, so you can see we use scikit-learn load sample images to load the two color images. Okay, one is a Chinese temple, the other is a flower. Okay, Chinese temple, well, this is a Chinese temple, by the way, right? Then we create two 7x7 filters. One is a vertical white line, okay, in the middle. Another one is a horizontal white line, okay. Well, as I said, okay, we already talked about that in that example, okay. But now we want to see how this is done in TensorFlow, okay. And apply them to both images using a convolutional layer built using TensorFlow's COMP2D. So again, the TensorFlow provides very convenient function that allows you to create a convolutional layer. You don't need to write it by yourself because it's pain in the neck, okay, to write this thing like from scratch all by yourself. Okay. Just like the fully connected, okay, fully connected, it's provided, it can be, it can just use the function provided by the TensorFlow to create like one hidden layer directly. Same thing, you can use the COM2D to create one like convolution layer together. Just by calling this function. Okay. So with zero padding and a stride of two. Okay. Finally it pass one of the resulting bigger okay visual maps. Okay. So just like one of them shown slide. Okay. So here, okay, you can see that we import load sample images. Okay, so here, okay, we just data set, we try to load the sample image. Okay? And then, okay, we need to create two filters. Okay? So, filter test, okay, it's going to be this shape, okay? 7-7, okay? And the channel, okay? And the size is 2 here, because we have two different filters. We have two different filters. So even for filter, the shape is like four dimension, okay, four dimension. Okay, and the filters test, okay, now this color just means that they are all zeros. They are all zeros for that dimension. Okay, and three just means that we have that that line. Okay. To fill the three for all the elements, all the elements in that meet like that has like this three just means like if the index is three, we make it one. Sorry, index three we make it one. Okay, and no matter. What the first dimension, the third dimension is, okay, as long as the second dimension is 3, it's 1. Okay, and this is the first filter, so index here is 0. Okay, and then here is we just put the horizontal line, okay, to be 1. Okay, and 3, because the feature map is 7 by 7, right? So 3 having to be the middle index. It range from 0 to 6. Okay, so now we create a graph with input times plus a convolutional layer, okay, applying the two filters, okay. So X basically holds the input, okay. And then, okay, convolution equal to this, we call a COM2D to create a convolution layer, okay. We provide the input to this layer. We have the filters, okay, the filters, filters that we create is here, okay, we have two filters, okay, we pass these two filters here. The stride length is 2, okay, so it's 1, 2, 2, 1, I will explain this one, okay, shorter, I will explain this one shorter. Padding is the same, okay, this one, I will explain this one, okay, okay. And then, here is the X. Execution phase, which is running. Okay, and then we use this show, okay, to basically plot the image, and choose two images to feature that. Okay, that's it. Okay, that's pretty much about it. Okay, so. I think the other part, we probably don't need to worry about the explanation. We only need to worry about this explanation, the stride, okay, the stride, because the stride is 4D, okay, it looks like it has four elements. So what are these four elements, okay? So, okay, so the two central elements are the vertical and horizontal stripe. Okay, the first and the last element must currently be equal to 1. Okay, The first and last one must be equal to one. Okay. They made one day. Okay, so this, the first one, the last one must be one. Okay. What is this one? What is this one? Okay. This one means like, So the first one is used to do a batch strike. Okay, batch strike. Okay, remember like we load like two images as one batch, right? And then okay, we apply these both images. Okay, assuming you have like 100 images as one batch. Okay, then you can actually apply this. Right now we are applying the stripe on the vertical layer, the horizontal on each image, right? Okay, but if you want to apply this stripe on, on the consecutive images in one batch, okay, this is what we call batch stripe. Okay, batch stripe. Okay, or skip some images, okay? Then the first element is used for that purpose. The first element, this one, here, is used for that purpose. But unfortunately, it is not supported now. Okay, it's not supported. We don't, the TensorFlow does not support batch stripe at this moment. Okay, in the future, it may support batch stripe. I don't know if TensorFlow 2.0 support that already or not. Okay? And the fourth one is like for the channel strike. The fourth one is the you can do the strike on the channel. Okay, you can do the strike on the channel. Okay, channel strike. Okay, to skip. Some of the previous layers, visual maps, or channel. Okay, but again, okay, these two are not commonly well. Even if they are available, we don't use them. Now. Right? So we conceptually one is horizontal, one is vertical. Okay. One is horizontal stripe, one is vertical stripe. Okay. This one is, as I say, batch stripe. This is channel stripe, which will stay to be one. Okay. As for the padding, okay, padding. There are only two available values for this padding option. One is valid, one is set. Okay. If we set it to be valid. Computer layer does not use zero padding. Okay, may ignore some rows and columns at the bottom and the right of the input image. Okay, so here. Okay, if we use valid, it will not pad the previous layer. Okay, there's no zero padding. Okay, so we'll start from here. Okay, and then say the reset field is like 3x2. So the first one is going to be this size. Okay, and we keep move up. Okay, and then until we reach the end. Okay, and we stop. We do not go over the limit. We do not go over the limit. In that case, you can imagine, okay, the next layer, well, the size will be slightly smaller, right? Slightly smaller, okay, because, say like this one is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So if the width is 3, then you are going to have, and the stride length is 1, so then you are going to have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, okay, 7 for the width. Now, okay, after one, after, you know, if you use the belly, okay, the next layer, okay, the width will be deep, reduced to 5. Okay, because it is going to use the belly instead of zero padding. Okay, so that's the concept. Okay, but as I said, like another situation, which is quite zero padding. Okay, it's more reasonable to apply zero padding to make like each layer the same size. Okay, the consecutive layer the same size. Make sure. Okay. So padding option. Okay. Input width 13. Filter width 6. Stripe is 5. Okay. So for example here. Okay. So if we do that. Okay. This is like 13. So. We do this, okay, the first time, okay, it's like the width is like how much? 6. 1, 2, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So next time, we move 5 position to the right because the stride length is 5. So from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So we have these two inputs, okay? If the padding is valid. And we cannot get the third. We cannot get the third one. Why? Because if we want to get the third one, then we need to move 5 positions to the right again. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. We start from here. Okay. We start from here. But if we don't have. If you want to get the third one, well, we have to pass something here. Otherwise, we couldn't get the result from. Of the width 6. It's just we just don't have enough bits, okay, to do that. Okay? So if you use a value, okay, we are going to use just some of the just these two bits or these two neural output will be enough. Okay? So that's like something like that. Okay. That work, okay. If this is 13, okay, and stride length is 5, okay, as I said, okay, 13 divided by 5, it's 2.6, right, 2.6, because we use the belly padding, so we can only get 2, okay, instead of 3, okay. But if we use the same padding, if you use the same option, so then you can see we are getting 6 here, and then another 6 here, and then another 6 here. Okay, we have three neurons. Okay, you may argue, well, apparently in order to get these three neurons, okay, you do need to pass some zeros. But should we pad all the zeros at the end? Or should we pad all the zeros at the beginning? Or like here, we pad 1 0 at the beginning and 2 0 at the end. Okay. The TensorFlow is going to try to put this zero padding kind of evenly distributed at the beginning and at the end. Okay. So if it's 3, so it's going to put 1 here and 2 there. Okay? If it's 4, it's going to put 2 here, 2 there. Okay? That will be done automatically. build down, right? Okay, so that is how TensorFlow deal with like zero pattern. Okay, so that's the difference between different pattern options. Okay, any question? So if no question, then let's take 10 minutes break and come back and we'll continue our discussion.